Hello to all, and today I am about to share with you something that may sound as an oddity, because since the creation of the Watches TV some 7 years ago, yes, time really flies, well, since 7 years we had never been to Glashütte, home of German mechanical watchmaking. So how strange or even awkward is that? So better late than never, and now this abnormality has finally been addressed, and this thanks to the organizers of the Dubai Watch Week, who invited a little group of journalists to go and witness what the Saxony region is all about when it comes to watchmaking. So a massive thanks to them of having pulled something as interesting as this 4-day trip. And I've already said it, but the Dubai Watch Week is definitely a pretty singular event and organization where the notion of knowledge sharing and transmission is at its core. And I can only salute this, trying to do our share here on the Watches TV. Okay, so let's now dive into this experience, and there is quite a lot to be said, but I'll really try to be as concise as possible. So first of all, let's go back in time and understand why this region of Germany has become a home of its watchmaking industry some 170 years ago, a time when Germany was not yet a country as we know it today. So anyhow, during the first half of the 19th century, the region of Glashütte was facing a major problem. Silver mining used to be the main activity, and when the mines ran out of the precious metal, well, the entire region suffered directly from this downfall. So it was decided at the political level that to reinvigorate the region, watchmaking would be developed, and it was a small group of people that were tasked to implement this. So not really an empirical or historical development, but a pure decision with consequences up to today. And we have visited the Glashütte Watchmaking Museum, and it was really interesting to hear that our guide was referring to this group of four guys as our founding fathers. So felt very respectful, and these names included Ferdinand Adolf Lange, who established the brand that still bears this family name in 1845, but also Moritz Grossmann, initiator of the Glashütte German School of Watchmaking, and the museum is now set in what used to be the school. Plus Julius Assmann and Adolf Schneider. So working a bit like the same principle we find in La Chaux-de-Fonds here in Switzerland, the entire activity of this little town of Glashütte revolved around watchmaking. Suppliers would specialize in various types of craftsmanship, gear trains, regulating organs, cases, hands, pinions, etc. And it's the juxtaposition of all these competencies, this division of labor, that enabled the region to develop fairly fast and be internationally recognized as a source of highly qualitative timekeeping objects. So to make a long story short, the region continued to successfully develop itself, but then came World War II, and Dresden and some of its surrounding paid a pretty heavy price, being almost wiped out by some serious Allied bombings at the end of the war, and then being emptied out by Soviet forces who took whatever they could back home. I mean, machines, drawings, inventory. So there was really not much left of the Glashütte watchmaking industry in the late 1940s, and whatever remained had now been consolidated in a special consortium called GUB, G-U-B, for Glashütte Uhrenbetriebe, which mainly produced watches for what was now the Eastern Bloc, Saxony being part of the newly founded East Germany. And it was only once the wall fell in 1989, sorry about that, and with that the German reunification, that a second chance was given to the revival of this region. And that's when we hear the name Lange once again, because it's really under the impulsion of Walter Lange, that's the great nephew of Ferdinand Adolf Lange, and a man who we mentioned in our Who's Who of Watchmaking dedicated to the Richmond Group, Mr. Gunther Blumlein, that the industry started all over again. And this was naturally a pretty courageous move, because to develop super high-end watchmaking in what was previously a communist region, well, the two didn't necessarily fit very well together in the same sentence. So 1989 was a key moment, and some other intrepid visionaries joined the move, and one of the first brands to believe in a strong future was Nomos, the brand that today is enjoying a fantastic success. So we had the chance to visit various Nomos production sites, and I can really tell you that when you visit Glashütte, you can really feel that Nomos is a big player. You have Nomos buildings scattered everywhere in what remains a pretty small city, and even the word city sounds probably a bit too big. I mean, Glashütte is found in a valley approximately 40 minutes from the main Saxony town of Dresden, and everything, I mean, every brands are found in a pretty small radius. There's definitely some kind of family feeling when you walk across it. So coming back to Nomos, we couldn't unfortunately film everything we saw, but let's say that is a pretty big and serious operation. I mean, for instance, I was totally blown away when they told us that they are 300 employees. Really didn't realize this, but now I believe that this number might get much higher in the years to come. So Nomos is a cool brand. They have cool products with a distinctive no-nonsense design. They produce their own movements. They have cool communication, and best of all, I mean, their prices are really acceptable. So quite a simple recipe for success when you say it like this. But okay, it didn't happen overnight. I mean, there's a lot of work and commitment that has been put into it. And the nice part is that it doesn't prevent all the people that we met there, I mean, including the founder of the brand, to be really nice and down-to-earth people. A very pleasant and interesting visit, I must say. We then visited something that was fairly new for me, as I mainly knew the brand Wempe as being one of the most important retailers of Germany, and Germany being naturally a very important market for watchmaking. So their installation very nicely set in what used to be an observatory initially set to precisely calculate time, which would then be used as reference time by the various glasshütte watchmakers. So now this function is naturally not as relevant, but what was really interesting to grasp is that Wempe has also developed this facility as a training facility for some of their young watchmakers. I mean, those watchmakers that would then operate in the retail business of Wempe for services, for instance. I mean, watch servicing, for instance.
Also, die Ausbildung ist eine sehr, sehr wichtige Basis für die Uhrmacherei. Es gab Jahre, in denen die Quarzuhr die Überhand hatte über den mechanischen Uhren. Da wurden keine Uhrmacher ausgebildet. Diese Uhrmacher fehlen uns heute. Wir wollen natürlich unsere Tradition, unsere Kompetenz, wollen wir auch an unsere Mitarbeiter weitergeben, andere junge Mitarbeiter weitergeben, die von der Basis an die Uhrmacherei kennenlernen, erlernen bei uns und somit auch mit in die Geschäfte tragen können. Sie können in die Geschäfte gehen als Serviceuhrmacher, als Verkaufsmitarbeiter, in der Fertigung arbeiten, in dem Service arbeiten. Und wir wollen unserem Kunden ja auch einen Rundum-Service bieten.
Our visit continued on the following day with the visit of Lange & Heine, a pretty niche brand, very high-end, and we had covered them during the last Baselworld, so it was obviously very nice for us to see in the flesh how their operation was set up. I mean, this brand nevertheless is not located in Glashütte per se, but in the outskirts of Dresden, in a very nice little house, and you have to realize that we are talking less than 100 watches being produced per year. Well, actually closer to 50, and they take the notion of fine finishing to some extreme level. For instance, and this I had never heard of before, but as Marco Lang was explaining to us, they actually polish the thread of screws, I mean the ones that are used in their watches. So I'm not talking about the head of the watch, of the screw, sorry, but the thread itself. And when we asked why would they bother to do this, well, Mr. Lang very proudly told us that for him it was very important that in 100 years time, when another watchmaker would service one of their watches, well, then this watchmaker will appreciate the work done at the time. So quite crazy, right? So yes, this level of finishing is simply remarkable, but this is something that can be said in general for the people we met everywhere. It's part of their signature and fully demonstrates again their commitment in producing super qualitative timepieces. So this is something we also got to witness, for instance, when we visited Moritz Grossmann, a brand relaunched a few years back with some kind of long-term thinking and living all that has been put in place. And that's also a pretty remarkable operation. I mean, it's quite courageous, I must say, and I really appreciate the effort, passion, and pure will that Christine Hütter has injected into this endeavor.
So if you look there, you see it's a German movement. So we work with a 2/3 plate, not with a 3/4 plate, which is usual in Glashütte. Then we use a micrometer screw as regulation system, which Grossmann put in a lot of pocket watches. And then we are a little bit special because we changed the view of the movement a little bit. We use white sapphires, so we have rice chateaus, and also the screws are set up on the plate. All is hand engraved, also all letters of Moritz Grossmann logo on the plate. And then we have white stripes, we use a pillar movement, so we have our own balance system, a step in the balance cock. you can see that the movement is more quiet, not so colored, and it's our Moritz Grossmann taste and our Moritz Grossmann style. The finishing is really high, so we train our people 6 to 12 months. And if you look into our movement, some parts like on the ratchet wheel between the teeth, it's hand finished. We finish parts which nobody normally will do, and also in the traditional way, so we try different woods, kind of woods. We also work with zinn. If you look at our hands production, some people would say it's crazy to produce three hands a minute, hour and second hand, and in one day, three hands in one day. But I think you feel, if you have a look at our watches, they are so simple. But if you look really at the hand and you see it with an eyeglass, it's different, and that style that makes Moritz Grossmann.
Our final visit was by Tutima, and though we mainly know this brand for more affordable and more general public type of watches, their Glacier operation is focused on producing high-end timepieces, from chronos to even minute repeaters. So again, we had the chance of visiting the full but rather small facility, and it's always nice to meet new people and see how they work and how they are set up. So that was it for this very first visit of German watchmaking, and we know that it doesn't only stop in Glashütte. You can find other brands in other parts of Germany, and some significant ones. So we neither visited all the brands that are actually located in Glashütte, such as A. Lange & Söhne or Glashütte Original, to name the two most well-known ones. But one last thing I wanted to mention is that we got an extra final and fantastic surprise as we met a man whose contribution in helping redevelop mechanical watchmaking after the quartz crisis of the late 70s, early 80s is simply immense. This man is Mr. Gerd Rüdiger Lange, founder of Chronosuisse, a German brand, yes, but a brand which solidly relied on Swiss components when it came to the production of their timepieces. So in a certain way, he stuck with the basics of what mechanical watchmaking is. And in an adverse environment at the time, his dedication and commitment played a major role in repositioning mechanical watchmaking as something reputable and full of substance. So it was a real treat of being able to spend some quality time with this man who belongs to the Hall of Fame of watchmaking. Yes, that's a new concept I think we could work on, meaning those men and women whose roles have been critical in pursuing watchmaking as a form of essential art, as simple as that. So we had a lovely dinner, his modesty and simplicity really came through, and also he showed us some example of his collection, his private collection. I mean, the man is a very serious collector, I mean, very serious chronograph collector, and actually I would love to do a report just on his collection. Well, I can really say that this trip was extremely interesting, and I'm very happy of having had the opportunity of getting this report to you, thanks to the Dubai Watch Week people. And of course, I can't thank them enough for this. So something I would just like to add is that it was quite moving to witness the pride of the different workers we got to meet. I mean, witness their commitment and the fact that they were all really happy to share this with us. It was also nice to talk about our passion with some colleagues, of course, and demonstrate once again that we still have so many stories to tell about watchmaking, still so much to uncover. So, to summarize it all, well, let's just go for a Viva Watchmaking. Thanks for watching. See you real soon.